And so I hit the trailer hitch on my back, and then I bounced off that onto the pavement on my back again, and then onto my side. And I'm thinking, as I bounce onto my side, I'm thinking, I'm yelling in my head at the driver, stop, you're killing me. And as soon as I yelled that out in my head, the tire from the trailer, he was pulling a trailer which had our ice chests and our inner tubes in it, you know, one of those trailers, and it ran over my neck and my head.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Sharon Kumara. How are you doing, Sharon?
Doing great. Thank you, Alex. It's an honor to be here.
Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your remarkable stories with us today. So my very first question is, what was your life like before you had your first NDE?
My life, well, it was pretty normal. I was a bookkeeper for an oil company. That was my last career before my NDE for about 15 years. I did live in Texas, in San Antonio, Texas, independent oil company. So I was, I was kind of a partier. I loved to party, loved to go out on the weekends and have fun, you know, and in Texas, that's kind of the law that you're supposed to go drink beer and dance country music, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, if you don't do that, then you don't fit in. So I did that. And as far as my adult life, that's kind of what I did is I worked in an office. I was in that type of realm of being a bookkeeper and administrative type of person. My childhood, I don't remember very much. I'll explain a little bit about that later, but my parents divorced when I was six, and my sister and I, who grew up together, went to live with my grandmother when we were very young at that time, and or a little bit after that, because we did live with my dad and stepmother, but that didn't work out. So we went to live with my grandmother, and that's where a lot of the experiences happened that I'll share a little bit as a child. And I don't remember a lot, like I'm saying, although as my memory started coming to me after my NDE, I realized, mm-hmm. okay, well, this is why I don't remember that.
Now, were you spiritual or religious before your NDE?
I was raised Catholic, but I was not a good Catholic. I would fight my grandmother to go to church. My parents were not religious. They were both raised Catholic, but they didn't take us to church or anything like that. And I would actually fight a poor woman. I'd make her chase me around the house to take me to church. Yeah, I felt so bad afterwards when I remembered that. But so no, I was not a good Catholic. I mean, I believe that, you know, Jesus existed, and I knew that some form of God or higher intelligence did, because I knew that they must have, somebody must have protected me throughout my life, because I, like I said, I was a partier, so I probably should have died a long time ago.
Oh, I look back at my days, and I'm like, I have no idea how we survived. Generally, our generation, as a general statement, smoking on airplanes, no seatbelts.
And we survived it.
And then now we have to like bubble wrap our kids. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, it's insane. Like, we survived without all this, you know. Right. So tell me about your first NDE. What happened?
Okay. Well, if I could, I'd like to share the one in 2001, because then that leads up to, because then I remembered the one when I was nine.
Go for it.
Which is actually the first one, but the second one in my memory. Mm-hmm. So yeah, in 2001, I lived in San Antonio, and some girlfriends and I went inner tubing down the Guadalupe River. And it was June 11th, 2001. It was for a girlfriend's birthday, and we had a really great day. It was the end of the day, around 5 o'clock. And so the outrigger that we rented the inner tubes from would take us down the river, or up the river, I guess, and then pick us up in another area afterwards. And so we parked our cars at their parking lot. And so at the end of the day, we were done. We pulled out, got out of the river, and we were standing there to get on the bus, the shuttle bus, to take us back to our cars. And there was five of us. And so we, and they had these little school buses, the little, what we call the short bus, right? Those little
Sure.
school buses. So I went to get on. I was the first one of in our group, and I went to get on, and I saw that the bus was already full. All the seats were full. So I actually turned around to get back off, but people were saying, kind of pushing us, you know, my friends and I, and you know, to get on. And there's, and the people in the bus were saying, come on, come on, you can stand in the aisle. So I got on, and I was the first one in the group, and they packed us on the bus, and I was up against the back door of the bus. And so as he's driving down the road, he packs us on, and as he's driving down the road and shifting gears, I believe it was third gear, as he's moving away from a red light, and it's just a couple miles, I guess, to the outriggers business, the back door pops open and I fall out of the bus. Yeah. And I'm thinking, did I just fall? I can't believe I just fell out of this bus as he's driving down the road. And my back hit the trailer hitch. I remember all this. My back hit the, I actually grabbed my, just automatically grabbed in front of me. And my friend, who was 5 months pregnant, was standing in front of me. So thank God I didn't grab her. And so it was just an instinct. And so I hit the trailer hitch on my back. And then I bounced off that onto the pavement on my back again, and then onto my side. And I'm thinking, as I bounce onto my side, I'm thinking, I'm yelling in my head at the driver, stop, you're killing me. And as soon as I yelled that out in my head, the tire from the trailer, he was pulling a trailer which had our ice chests and our inner tubes in it, you know, one of those trailers, and it ran over my neck and my head.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh God.
So then I popped out of my body. That's the point where I popped out through my head, out of my body. And I'm looking down, and I had to piece this together afterwards. And I'm looking down on the scene as I'm up above. And I'm looking down on the scene, and I see what's happening. And I remember thinking that there was, because I was, the bus was still going. He didn't know I had fallen out. And so there was another big, you know, those commuter buses that was coming towards my body. And I'm thinking, oh, I hope that they don't run over my body, because that would really mess it up. But I didn't feel afraid. I didn't feel upset or anything like that. I did, I take that back. One thing that upset me was that I was thinking, we just had, this is really, this kind of really sucks, because my friends and I just had a really good day, and here I go and die on them. That's what I, that was my thought. Here I go and die on
them. It's a bummer.
It's
a bummer.
It's
a bummer.
It's kind of a bummer. Yeah.
Way to bring the, you're harshing my buzz here. You're crashing the day here, Sharon.
Exactly. That was my thought. Here I go and die on them when we had such an awesome day. That's really going to ruin my friend's birthday. She's not going to want to celebrate her birthday anymore on that day, kind of thing. You know, that was my thought. And I'm thinking about that. And then I'm thinking, because I didn't have any attachment to my body, mm-hmm. none whatsoever. And I knew I had died. I just knew. And I'm like, okay, well, I've done this before many times, and this is apparently again another time. So then I'm thinking, okay, about my boyfriend at the time, and I'm thinking, well, he'll be fine, he won't, you know, he'll be sad for a while, but he'll get over it. And then I'm thinking about my sister and her family, because we're really close. I'm like, well, she'll be fine. Her, you know, she'll be sad for a while, but she'll get over it, and I know everyone's gonna be fine. And then I thought about my mom, because I kind of took care of my mom. We were really close, and she just lived down the road from me at that time. And as soon as I think about my mom, I feel a presence behind me. And so I turn around, and it's my stepfather, who had died in 98, who pretty much, his passing changed everything for me. Okay? And so I see him, and I'm really, really happy to see him, because we were close. Whew. And so I see him, and he tells me telepathically right away. And he looks really good, by the way. He died of lung disease and he was sick and on oxygen and all that. And but he's still wearing these horn rim glasses because that's his signature to show me, because I used to make fun of him when they weren't cool, you know, the black glasses. Right. Remember when they weren't cool? And I'd say, Dad, can you get rid of those ugly glasses and get some wire rims? You look like a dork. And I would tell him that. And so that's his joke, because he was really funny. And so when he appears to me in the spirit world or in my dreams or out of bodies, he's wearing those glasses, which is really funny. So he had intuits to me, it's not your time. And I'm like, I'm like, what do you mean? You know, kind of thing. I didn't understand. I said, but I want to stay here with you. And as he's into, we're having that conversation, a little bit of a conversation to his right, to my right, his left, I see a tunnel open up. Okay. And I see who I recognize as my ancestors. And I can't, and you know, it's hard to tell if they were in the tunnel, if they were, you know, where they were, but I knew who they were. And they were also people, ancestors that I didn't know here, but I knew were my ancestors there that when I saw them. And so this tunnel is opening and I look at them and I'm like, they don't look really happy for me to be here. There wasn't any kind of celebration, which obviously I was used to when you die. And I've heard from spirit too, that there's a celebration, right? And so, so they weren't celebrating that I was there. They just kind of looked, their faces were kind of just neutral. Mm-hmm. As I'm gazing at that, and it wasn't that long afterwards when, and it's hard to put this in time, linear times, right? You know that. Right. You talk to enough people. And so, and probably have your own experiences. But but I see this huge golden white, like the sun, like a portal sun. And it's off in the distance from my perspective. And so I see that, and my attention is drawn away from that tunnel to this sun portal. And it's starting already. And so I see a figure, and I'm just gazing at it because it's just, wow, that's so, you know, wow. So I'm gazing at it, and I see a figure moving out of it toward me. As this figure comes closer, I recognize this figure as Jesus, Yeshua, who I perceived as. It was a light being, basically, a light being. And I perceived this person as Jesus, who I call Yeshua. And as soon as I recognized him, because I recognized him, as soon as I did, I flew to him. I was already having out-of-body experiences at that time, conscious out-of-body experiences, and I flew to him. I was immersed in this this love and light that's I can't even describe, and I was it felt like at first, well, first thing he tells me is it's not your time, just like my dad did, it's not your time, and I say, but I want to stay with you. It's telepathic. I want to stay with you. I want to stay with you. Whew. And he laughs, chuckles, like, I know, but he's intuiting to me, your work's not done, what you came here for, that type of thing. And I know now that if he would have let me stay, I'd probably be mad because I'd be missing what's going on, you know, because that's why we're here. And so not that he would anyway, but and so I'm having that conversation, and as I'm in his energy, I feel this merging of light between him and me, where I become him and he becomes me, type of thing. I'm in that light merging, and it's difficult to express, but I'm feel it's tangible. The light, the love is tangible. And I I'm thinking, if my I can't smile wide enough, I'm going to break my face, because I'm a big this huge big smile. It makes me smile. I just feel so at peace, loved, in the light again, home with him. And so we're there for a little while, and he asked me, would you like to go on a journey with me? And I said, well, yeah, of course. He extends his hand for me to take his hand, and I take his hand. As soon as I take his hand, everything changes, and it feels like movement, that we're moving through the cosmos. And, you know, I can't tell if the cosmos is moving through us or we're moving through the cosmos. It just feels like movement. And I see these lights flying by us. Okay, stars, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. And so he takes me there, and then I see another light off in the distance. And we move, and it's a little portal, another little portal. Okay. And so we go down this little portal, and then I see a planet in front of us. We're above this planet. I recognize this planet as a water planet that I am, have an existence or expression on, as kind of a home planet for me. Mm-hmm. We all kind of have, you know, home star system, home planets, what I've learned since then. And I recognize this planet. So we're hovering above this planet. And there's kind of a communication there, where he's helping me understand what we're doing. Okay. Yeah. So it's not really words. It's intuitive, intuitive communication. So we're hovering above this planet, and I am feel and become my, how do I put it? I become one with the planet. Mm-hmm. My perspective is one is the planet. I am the planet, and I have so much love and so much empathy for everyone, everything, every part of my planetary body. Mm-hmm. I have so much love for them, and for that part of my body, me. And so, and I move my awareness from there to back to me as Sharon, and we move down closer and closer to the planet, and then we dive into the water, and we're on the planet, and I meet reunited with my family, my water or my aquatic family. And he's at that point, I don't feel his awareness or feel him in my awareness as mm-hmm. much as I'm just really happy to see my family, really happy. Mm-hmm. And it's like I really never left. And so I'm there with him. And that's how it was whenever I connect with him and connected with him then. And so I'm with my family, and I'm aware of a mate there, water and aquatic children, that type of thing. Mm-hmm. So I spent some time there. I don't know how long mm-hmm. in terms of but as the memories came, I mean, I was there for quite a while, and I kept going back. I kept going back. And so at some point, or he did tell
this
me.
This is all during the near-death experience still?
This is during the near-death experience, yes.
Got it, okay.
Yes. And he told me, you can come back here anytime in your mind, you know, in your meditations type of thing, okay? So I did. And I when I would go later, I didn't want to come back.
Right.
So as I'm there experiencing that, I don't actually recall being taken out of there and back, you know, out of that experience. But I do remember being slamming back into my body. Okay. But I don't remember the conversation that we had, okay, about it at that point, okay, of being moving, transitioning from the water planet to my body, if that makes sense. Okay. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of conversation, intuitive conversation, that I recalled afterwards about the future of our planet, about my work here on the planet, or my mission kind of thing, and why, you know, and why I needed to come back, or why he chose for me, and we chose together. I did make an agreement with him. I said, okay, I'll go back if I'm able to remember you on a conscious level. That was my stipulation. I was making a deal with Jesus, right?
Isn't that funny? Right.
So, but I need to be able to remember you, because I realized at that moment when I was with him, that moment, that I missed him really, really badly in my life. So then I'm back in my body.
You get slammed back into your body?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I got slammed back into my body, and I jump up at that point. And what I recall, because I'm, you know, when you look at these things, you're from an observer's perspective in your memories. And so I recall that I jumped up. My girlfriends are freaking out. At that point, they were jumping off the bus, and they're freaking out. And I jump up and I run. I'm running around, you know, like, oh my God, I just can't. I know. Yeah. What just happened? And so I, my hair though is falling out, because I got, you know, they made fun of me at the hospital. They called the ambulance, and the ambulance came and got me. It took them a long time. They got lost in New Braunfels is New mm-hmm. Braunfels is yeah. South of Austin. And so, so it took them a while. They got lost for some reason. They gave them the wrong address or something. And so so we're sitting there waiting for a while. And I'm in shock at that point. So they take, you know, they put me on this spine thing and take me to the hospital. And they x-rayed me. And I didn't have a concussion. But they, I know, right? And my the only thing that with my neck in my head is that I have nerve damage, so I do have kind of a tremor, but I do have to maintain my back too. My back is, if I don't, you know, keep my back supple, that kind of thing, if it gets stiff, then it's pretty painful. But I didn't have anything broken, a lot of road rash, because we were wearing shorts and stuff, and so that my body was protected. Definitely.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And then, all right, so when you come back after this, you know, remarkable experience, how do you deal with it psychologically?
Well, I didn't remember when I came back. That was protected from that, because they knew, my guidance knew that it had to be a slow process for me, and it had to be after my mother passed, because, And my mother passed in 2003, and it was after that she helped me remember him. She actually helped me from the spirit world and remember the experience. So yeah, it was huge for me to be able to integrate that. He calls it my quickening. There was so much of my childhood and things like that, and being able to integrate a lot. It took me a couple years to be able to put it together. I'd have flashes. All of a sudden, I'm sitting there like,
got it.
Oh my gosh. Wow, that makes sense. That's what, you know, that type of thing. And also in meditations.
So after your near death experience in 2001, for the next couple years, you're processing it. It's kind of coming in and out, back and forth, correct? When do you remember your first near-death experience as a child?
It was after that time, because I was working with Yeshua in my meditations. I made a commitment. So it was around 2003. 2003 is when things just started overflowing for me. 2003, after my mother passed, she passed April 4th, 2003. After that, I was in meditation. I made a commitment with him that I would be in my room at 9 p.m. every night and meditate with him. So I did. And things started coming to the surface for me, remembering my childhood. And what was the memories were coming through, and me as a child were being tortured and abused by family members. So there was one in particular I remembered, and as I became, you know, became more aware of it and everything like that. Sorry. I saw that there was more, okay, than just one. But the main one I remembered in when I was nine, and this was not my parents or anything like that. But I remembered when I was nine, I was in the backyard of my grandmother's house, and I was picking grapes and looking for agates. I'm a stone freak, so I look for agates in the backyard. That's when we could actually find them, you know, just in the backyard on, you know, on our property. And so, and then he was there, and he starts chasing me, and I fall down, and he's starting to beat me. He liked to beat me. So he's beating me, and he hits me so hard underneath my ribs, and I felt this intense pain. Like he had, I don't know if he broke him or what, but that didn't come through. But I pop out of my head again. Okay. At that point, I felt this immense peace, just pure peace. And this was very different, because I don't see anyone or hear anything. I'm in this darkness, and I'm just floating in this darkness. And I didn't realize what that was until just a couple years ago, or a year ago, I guess, when I talked to someone on my channel as well. And she called it the void, where she ended up in this darkness. And so it's not like a dark, like we would know dark, but it's just a void. And I was in what she called the void. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's what that was. And I felt so peaceful and supported. And I knew that I was a part of everything. Everything was a part of me. It was more of an awareness, like with the light, I'm just filled with so much love and light. Within that void, it's an awareness, if that makes any sense, of being a part of everything. And I could bring my awareness, expand it, and also bring it back within me, kind of like the planet. And so, but it was just this expansive galactic universal awareness. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how long I was there. Floating in this peaceful state, because I was suffering trauma. So that was the gift from God to help, you know, bring me in that peaceful, supported state. And I just felt totally supported. Mm-hmm. And I notice off to my right a light. Okay. Off to my right, there's a light, and it becomes brighter and brighter. And then Yeshua is there. Jesus is there. And this is the first one. Jesus is there, and he's moving toward me. And there's nothing really underneath this, nothing we're standing on. He's moving toward me, and he says very clearly to me, "You've suffered enough, child. You don't have to go back." And he's crouched down in front of me. And I say, "But I want to, because I haven't done what I finished to do. I need to go back." And this is a 9-year-old's awareness, right? So I had that expanded awareness within a 9-year-old body, but I didn't have, but you know, not that body. But so I had that awareness. I haven't finished what I went there to do. I need to finish my mission. And he asked mm-hmm. me, "Are you sure?" And I said, "Yes." And then I'm back in Bam. My body. Mm-hmm.
So you were, when you were in that near death experience, you were looking at it through a 9-year-old's eyes. It wasn't like a high, you weren't all of a sudden aware of the entire makeup of the entire universe all of a sudden.
No, I was, no, I didn't. If I did, I didn't bring that back, you know, and that, you know, that's a process for sure. But yeah, no, I was looking at it as I was expanding. I was understanding, I guess I should say, understanding that we are all connected, that there is no separation. I do remember that we were just had that, I had that expansive experience, expansive mind experience, that I'm more than just a 9-year-old. It was like remembering. I was remembering that type of thing. And then as I, and then I could also bring it back to the 9-year-old.
Now, but you didn't remember any of this until 2001 or after 2001 in that general area.
Yes.
Yeah, 3 or so. So you didn't bring any of that back with you. You didn't remember any of it. So it didn't, did it affect you in any way during your childhood?
Yes. Yes. I was, I was a very, very painfully shy child. I didn't have friends. I was afraid of everything. I had basically agoraphobia as an adult. Yeah.
Sure. Because of the trauma.
Mm-hmm. Although I didn't know why.
Right.
I didn't know why. Yeah. I thought, well, my parents got divorced and, you know, maybe I'm just too sensitive or something. But, you know, I didn't remember any of that until that time. Although I will say that I would have dreams about being abused and things like that. But, you know, I thought, well, maybe that's just something I'm working through, you know, where I feel in, you know, I feel vulnerable in a situation in my life or something like that kind of thing. And also there, the main family member that I remember, I didn't remember being that or seeing him that much in my life as a child. Mm. Hardly ever being around him. And I would see people that would remind me of him. And I think to myself, why am I thinking about him? I don't have any kind of connection or, you know,
right,
with him in the family. Yeah. So, and my sister, my sister doesn't have any memory of anything, you know. She's totally opposite than me. She has the family, you know, the home, the house, the family, and I've always been kind of the weirdo in the family. Weirdo.
The weirdos are always the most interesting, my dear. I hate to tell you.
She's turning more weird now.
I would much rather sit down at a bar with a weirdo talking about interesting things or at a party or something than someone who's straight. They're much more entertaining. So when you were in your second near-death experience, you said that you saw your ancestors, but they weren't recognizable family members of this lifetime. They were ancestors, almost like a soul family, if you will.
Yes. Some of them were my grandparents. Okay. I recognized them. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. But the others I wouldn't have recognized here. Met them on the street or something, but there I knew them. So
but soul you had group that feeling.
Is a good idea. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. The soul group. And then did you come back with any, real quick, you didn't have a life review at all.
Not that I recall.
Okay. Not that you recall, but you are aware, obviously you've done some research at this point.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there was no life. Yes. Yeah, so no life review, no council of elders, no tour. You had a heck of a tour throughout the universe to another planet. So to be fair, you had a pretty interesting ride, to say the least.
It was interesting for me. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you that, after, when you came back, were there any after effects of the near-death experience that you started to see or have abilities or have awarenesses or sensitivities that you didn't prior?
Well, I was always a psychic child, but I pushed it down because, I mean, I see dead people kind of thing, you know, that's how it was when I was a child, and I would have prophetic visions and dreams. But I shoved it down because I was raised Catholic, and when we live with my grandmother, you know, there, that's something that we just didn't talk about, or it just was a no-no, and it scared me. I saw my grandfather floating in the window, because we, when we were staying there, my sister and I lived on or slept on the second floor, and he passed in the house, and I, you know, one night I wake up and I'm looking, and there he is floating, looking in the window at me, and I'm like, that's kind of weird. So yes, but I, you know, I had a sense of being spirits and things like that, but I didn't, it scared me because I didn't have anybody to help me.
As it would. You know, if I'm, that's the first question I always ask people, like, so you start hearing voices. Did you think you were going crazy? Like, you know, I know you're a channel now, but when you first hear it, what does that feel like? Because I'd imagine if all of a sudden you're just walking around and you see grandpa floating, you're like, depending on the age, education, experience that you have, no one guiding you, that could very much be terrifying.
Yes. Yeah. So I was very withdrawn anyway. And right. So I just went more within myself. Right. And yeah, the voices thing, because I did start channeling Neshua, or he, he's the one that got me to, I mean, he saved my life basically. And so did my stepfather when he passed. And so he's the one that got me to start, you know, automatic writing, journaling, that type of thing, getting all that out. And that's how the memories would start coming. So it was kind of a life review then, I guess you could say.
Okay. All right. Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah. And I know a woman who wrote a book about, she did her life review in this life, just started, and she had a spiritual transformative experience after she did that, while she was doing that. So it's a really good way to, you know, uncover that stuff. So that's how I started channeling.
Well, let me ask you this, because this is a question I get asked all the time, especially in the comments. Why is, I have the running joke on the show, is like, Jesus is the hardest working man in the afterlife, because he's everywhere all the time. Yeah. And people always ask, well, why is it always Jesus? Why isn't it Buddha? Why isn't it Krishna? Why is, and I have a couple of stories that it is Buddha and Krishna. But from your point of view, since you, I mean, I guess he would make the most sense for you, being raised Catholic, that makes, because if you were a Hindu, it might not be Jesus. It might be somebody else, right?
I agree. I believe that, that, you know, that they, us, he's a part of me. I'm a part of him. We're all a part of each other. And so whatever is in our life experience or experiences or other lives is what will appear to us and what we resonate with and what makes us feel loved and comfortable is what will meet us or appear to us if that happens. Yeah. So Jesus was the one that knew that.
Well, let me ask you this, because this is something I've heard from many near-death experiencers, is that when you have a near-death experience, besides the nine-year-old one, when you have one later in life, it's a wake-up call a lot of times. Mm-hmm. It is, you've gone off the path, or you need, you have, it's an out, another explanation, it's an out point. You kind of create these kind of exit strategies. Like, you can get out of 23, you can get out of 45, you're going to get out, you have exit strategies if you want to leave. Why do you think this happened to you? Why did you think at that moment that near-death experience happened to you? What was the purpose of it, you think?
I believe it was to help me uncover my childhood, help me heal from it, because that was really, really important, because I realized afterwards that this agreement I had with these family members, and the one in particular, needed to be healed, because you know, I do past life soul retrieval work. And so he's the one, Yeshua's the one who taught me about soul retrieval, fragmented souls, bringing fragmented souls into the whole. And so I believe that that is what I needed to do. And for, you know, that one in particular and others, because I hadn't healed completely. And, you know, I was just kind of floating through life, not really
partying,
caring about
a good time.
It. Yeah, yeah, partying. Yeah, just not really caring, you know, working at my boring job and, you know, and, you know, being that kind of a person, which is, you know, a nice person, of course, but just not caring about spirituality and that kind of thing.
And then why do you think, because you have a unique near-death experience from the mass amount that I've interviewed and spoke about, where you got to travel through the cosmos, went to another planet, visited another soul family. Why do you think that happened to you in this one? What was the purpose of that? Because many times when near-death experiences happen, things happen in the near-death experience that are very, everything's purposeful and custom designed for the soul going through it. Why do you think that was, what was the purpose in your mind, do you think?
Yeah, that's a good question, because I've thought about that, but I do believe that my soul wanted me to remember that planet. And I was, I remembered that once I finished my mission here on Earth, you know, with humanity, our planet here on Earth, that I can go back there and send a lot of my soul focus there, because that was a home planet for me. Is what I remembered. And like I said, during my meditations, I would go and not want to come back. So they'd have to bring me back. Yeah. And so I believe that was to help me remember that, a gift from my soul, my higher self, and help me remember that I am, we are multidimensional, and we have these respites, you know, or that we can tune into.
Now, You just mentioned soul retrieval. Can you explain that a little bit? What is soul retrieval?
Okay. So what I was taught and how I understand it, and I see it, and I can say how much it helped me, is that we come here to experience everything pretty much there is to experience. That's the good part of it. Because I was saying, if this is all that we got, if this life is all that God gave us, God source, we don't want to call it, gave us, then we got gypped, because there's so much to experience. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not just on this planet, but other planets too. And so just across the galaxy, universe. So we come here to experience, and the challenging experiences are the ones that give us soul growth, more soul growth. So we can choose challenging experience for soul growth. But unfortunately, or fortunately, we're, you know, in this realm, this dimension that we're moving up from, I'm pretty sure that our emotional, the emotion from the experience can be, or the trauma can be so traumatic for us, you know, so emotionally charged, that personality or that part of us can become like a ghost. And they basically are a ghost and fragmented from the oversoul. The idea is to bring that experience into the oversoul, and this is what I learned or remembered, bring those experiences into the oversoul so we can go experience something else. Mm. You know, our soul can experience something else as a fractal of our soul, of source. And so what we do is, when we haven't brought that experience into the whole because of the emotionally charged baggage, I like to call it baggage, then we choose to repeat certain karmic patterns, or that pattern, that experience, or some of that experience, so that we can be maybe triggered within that life to heal it. The idea is to close that karmic loop within that life experience. And our lives have been cut short, as I'm sure you know. And so we used to live a lot longer, and we had a lot more time to clear up our stuff, to pay our tab, I guess, and clear up our stuff in a current life, and then move on to the next shift, to other experiences. So we used to know how to do this, but we forgot how. And so we can go within and find that part of us and connect to that part of us, and just help them move in to our oversoul, have that conversation with that part of us, that personality, past life, whatever you want to call it. I mean, they do this kind of work in psychology, right? Mm-hmm. Bringing in our fragmented parts of us, fragmentation.
Right.
Yeah. To heal. And that's basically what it is, and what I found to be very helpful. And with the family member that I remembered during my childhood, when Yeshua was working with me with this, to bring that in during my meditations, he asked me to just have, you know, imagine his soul in front of me, or him in front of me, and just say, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, kind of thing. Just over and over, you know, fake it till you make it kind of thing. And then one day in my meditation, it hit me. I had this profound awareness that, because I was already seeing my past lives, this profound awareness that he and I had made this choice many, many lifetimes before that, where he would abuse me and kill me, that kind of thing. But it was so traumatic for me then, I didn't bring it in. So in the in-between life, we'd be having this conversation. Hey, you know, I didn't bring that in. Can you come back with me and kill me and abuse me again so I can, you know, so I can heal it? Yeah. So he agreed that he would do that in many lifetimes. And I saw where I was burned at the stake as a witch, and he was, and I saw him moving back and forth in front of me, and I'm floating up here. So I had to retrieve that one too. And I'm just above my body. And so all those lifetime times that were too traumatic for me, he agreed to lower his frequency so low, because I kind of got the better end of the stick, because he ended up being such a bad guy for me, and I'm sure others in his soul group, which he would have to work on. But with me, at least, I realized there's nothing to forgive. And he loves me so much. There's so much love there that he agreed to do this. So now he's free of this agreement, and I'm free of this agreement. And that was really huge for me.
What was the biggest takeaway you had from your near-death experience?
There's so many. the biggest takeaway, well, that we are multidimensional, that Jesus is real, that he does love me beyond anything I could ever imagine. And he is there for all of us, for whoever, you know, for anyone that calls on him, he's there. And he is that part of us, and we are, and we never really left home, and we're experiencing, so I know that's a lot of things, but that I'm loved beyond measure.
Well, I first of all, I want to thank you for telling me your story. It's profound, to say the least, and hopefully it helps people listening to it. I'm going to ask you a few questions. I ask all my guests, how do you define a fulfilling life?
A fulfilling life is a life where you are loved and you love others. Love drives you, or is fills your heart and your life, and you are helping others, a life of service to others as well.
If you had a chance to go back to that little girl, what advice would you give her?
That she's safe and she's going to be okay, and she is loved.
How do you define God or source?
Love.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
I believe it's to remember that we are love and expressing that. Yeah.
I see a theme here. I see a theme of love.
Do you? Okay. Yeah, that's right.
There's a theme of love in these answers. I see it. And where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing?
My website is sharonsananda.com, sharonsananda.com. Mm-hmm. And you can find everything about me there.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
That we are so much more than what we actually think we are. That we are amazing, powerful beings, and we are loved beyond measure. And everything's going to be okay. Just trust the universe, trust God.
Sharon, thank you again so much for this amazing testimony and this amazing conversation. I appreciate you, my dear.
Thank you, Alex.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.